Hey guys, welcome back to Gunchy Plans. Today is my 8-month bump date, which seems crazy, but you know, that's how you count, I guess, 1 month at a time. It is actually really feeling like it's getting to the end of this pregnancy. I'm feeling the end drawing very near, very quickly. And so I'm about a month away and this is where we are. So I'm gonna give you some updates on how we're doing. I got a request like just shy of the last of these that I didn't see in time to share some of the like TMI and weird and awkward and gross kind of details from the pregnancy. So I've accumulated a couple of those, but I'm gonna put them at the end of the video so that if that's not your thing, you can tune out before we get to the weird and gross stuff. But that will be at the end, so if that's your jam, stay tuned. I am 35 weeks right now, actually 36 weeks tomorrow as you're seeing this on Sunday. And so that means that I am now, or as of tomorrow, legally disabled. I am officially on maternity leave as of the end of business on Friday. So I'm recording this while I'm still working, but I'm looking forward to the next 4 weeks-ish of being off work and getting to really spend time like focusing on my own like physical well-being, as well as getting a little bit of quality time in with me and my older daughter before the baby comes and throws a monkey wrench into that relationship. Apparently, baby is currently about the size of like a 2-liter bottle of soda. Something else said a foot-long sub, though it also said 12.6 inches crown to rump. And foot-long subs are definitely shorter than that. I think babies are bigger than foot-long subs, so really she's the size of a slightly premature baby. The milestone that I noticed recently come up on my app was that at this point, if she was born and there was no like extenuating complications, she might require a very brief NICU stay but would not have any kind of lingering issues from it, or might not even require a NICU stay at this point at 35 or 36 weeks. So that's always the sort of thing that makes you feel a big sigh of relief knowing that you know, she's perfectly viable, doing great in there. You can feel her kicking every day. She's definitely running out of room, and I think, and I'll show you a little bit, that she might be starting to drop. You can tell that my belly is a lot bigger than I think even last month, and I'm at the point now where even my maternity shirts are starting to not quite cover up everything. So fortunately I have still been working from home, and I am going to be quarantining, so it's not like anyone's going to see my little beer gut sticking out. But yeah, I think that baby may actually be dropping, and I don't really know what that means, and I'm gonna ask the doctor if she's been, you know, engaged or not, but I have a feeling that she's head down. I'm pretty sure that she's head down. I've been feeling a lot of kicks in the sort of upper right and left, and then smaller movements that might be hands farther down. And she's definitely in there in a different way than Agnes ever was. My first baby, I don't know if you're new to my channel, my first baby was Breech, and so we had a planned cesarean. And she was sort of transverse for a long time, I think, and then she ended up being Frank Breech before she was born. And so my belly was always a sort of weird, lumpy, like one side bigger than the other, but laterally. And this time everything is a lot farther jutted forward, and I can kind of feel on the sides that she's pretty vertical in there, and I can kind of feel her moving around if I sort of push on her, what I'm pretty sure is her bottom. So it's definitely, it makes me feel a lot more confident, a lot more relieved, just knowing that she's in the right position, that everything, I believe, and again, we'll find out when I talk to the doctor next, I believe everything is in a good place to deliver vaginally. That is the hope. Because I'm a VBAC, my doctor doesn't want me to go past 41 weeks. So I am hoping that I go into labor naturally earlier rather than later, even though I'm more likely to go later because in a lot of ways it's like a first pregnancy because I've never been in labor before. My body doesn't necessarily know what to do yet. So we'll see. Keep me in your prayers. I have gained about 29 pounds since the beginning of this pregnancy. My last pregnancy total, I gained 30 pounds. You're supposed to be somewhere between 25 and 35 total. So I'm there, maybe a little bit faster than last time. I probably haven't been eating as healthy as I should be, but I have been more active, so, you know. You may have been able to tell in some of my most recent videos that I have started getting out of breath quickly. By the end of a video, when I've been talking for a long time, I'm starting to get out of breath by the end of it. So I'm trying to make a point of pausing to catch my breath between thoughts. So if you see a lot of jump cuts, that's why. I've been feeling the same lightheadedness when I try to bend over that's been there for a while. Definitely, I cannot sit on the floor anymore, and my poor daughter wants me to sit on the floor and play with her, but I tell her I have to sit either on the couch or at least on a stool. The good news there is that, you know, she's two, she wants to be getting into things. We have like several different stools around the house, different places that I can sit. In most rooms, there's usually a stool nearby that I can grab and sit to help her, you know, wipe her bottom on the potty or just to play with her in the living room. The SPD pain or pelvic girdle pain that I've been experiencing since very early on this time, this is around probably 14 weeks, I think, that I started to get the first couple of twinges. It's been getting worse and worse, especially when I roll over in bed. And so it's been, you know, one of those things at this point, just the last couple of days, I've been finding my hip has been going numb overnight. From laying on one side, and so it wakes me up, then I have to turn over, roll over in bed, which just causes me excruciating pain if I do it wrong at all. And then I wake up a few hours later and I'm on that other side. So it's not even the having to get up to pee that's making me wake up in the middle of the night, but it's that rolling over. I cannot do it without conscious, concerted, like very careful effort. So that is what my current struggle is. Fortunately, going into maternity leave, I'll be able to sleep in, maybe cuddle with the baby in the morning so that I can try to get a little extra sleep in there and make up for all the tossing and turning overnight. This month, I have just been trying to prepare myself both physically and spatially and psychologically, mentally for maternity leave. I have still been doing a lot of little reorganization projects around the house. I've been really happy with the progress I've made. That's been sort of the way that my nesting has manifested itself, as in really just wanting some spaces. Like this week I'm working on the kitchen, and that might move over into my maternity leave, spending some time reorganizing some of the cabinets that just kind of get disorganized, especially when you're stocking up extra supplies because you're in a pandemic. I really need to reorganize things so I can stop buying chicken stock thinking I don't have any. But we bought all of the stuff. We reorganized the nursery a little bit. I will link a video in the corner of the most recent cloth diaper video I did where I show my whole stash, including the newborn setup. Now that our older daughter is potty trained, we don't need the changing table for her anymore, so it's all set up for the baby's stuff. We've got her wardrobe out of the garage and into the drawers, washed and ready to go. Feeling like if she came this minute, we would have everything okay. We still have to pull out like the swing and the baby monitors and a couple of things, but feeling pretty ready there. So our two-year-old is moved into a toddler bed. We did not expect that to happen so soon, but when we got it, you know, I was planning on like having it on hand for when she tried to climb out of her crib, we would like switch at that point and have it ready to go. Well, the day it came, we said, well, are you interested? And we showed her some videos of little kids trying out their first toddler bed, and she was really excited to try it. So we set it up and she slept great from that very first night. So yeah, things on that front are very good. We have a crib free for the baby to use whenever she wants it. And the only thing that I guess would make our older daughter not quite as independent as would be ideal is that she can't pull up and down her own pants yet, so we can't just let her have free access to a potty at night because she would need our help still for that. But she did finally learn how to open doors just the last couple of days. So that's where we are in our toddler parenting right now. But as for actual prep for the new baby, finally got around to watching some like birth prep videos with my husband. And I've been watching a lot of like birth stories and vlogs, listening to the Birth Hour podcast, and just sort of mentally preparing myself for some of the ins and outs and possibilities. that I might be facing and trying not to get my hopes up too much for any specific kind of birth plan. I would love to be able to have an unmedicated VBAC. So that's my goal, but we'll see what happens. I'm feeling in some ways like I'm farther along than I ever was with Agnes, even though obviously I'm not. She was born on her due date by scheduled cesarean, and I'm 35 weeks. So like, obviously I have been more pregnant than I am right now before, but I never quite, at this point, like by 36 weeks, I already knew that she was breech. I already knew that she was likely to need to be delivered by cesarean. And so I never really got as mentally prepared for labor and delivery because I didn't really expect to go into labor, and I never did. In this other ways, like also I'm feeling the physical effects a bit more because I've got a toddler to run around after. But also I think the big thing is that with my first daughter, up until the second they were cutting her out of me, I was like, yeah, I can wait. I don't know if I'm ready to be a mom. And I knew that like my life would never be the same from the moment they placed her in my arms. And so I wasn't really feeling like in any real rush to get to that point. Like I was excited to be a mom, but sort of psychologically and not like viscerally. Well, 0 to 1 is an infinite change, but 1 to 2, it's just doubling. And in this case, it's like, I am a mom currently. I will continue to be a mom when I have 2. And I am feeling a lot more like excitement and urgency to get this baby out and start loving her. And also to see our older daughter as a big sister. I'm really excited for that. So I'm starting to like feel that anticipation already. And so I hope that we'll go a little bit early, but we'll see as far as, you know, in relation to the due date. But I'm feeling pretty done with this pregnancy and really hoping that we'll have a safe delivery very soon. So I always manage to plan these video schedules like just perfectly so that it's always like, oh, well, I have a doctor's appointment next week, so we'll have more news then. Again, I have a doctor's appointment this coming week. They're going to check baby's presentation with an ultrasound at that point, and they'll be able to confirm what I'm suspecting about her being vertex and ready to go. Like I said, I'll ask the doctor if she is engaged in my pelvis or not. I feel like she might be starting to. And I probably will decline a cervical check if it's offered, unless I'm starting to like feel contractions by then. It's time for my group B strep swab, which I thought was last time, but is apparently this time. And just kind of getting ready to think about labor and delivery. I don't know if any of the policies at the hospital regarding pandemic stuff has changed, but as of the last time I checked, it was still, they're allowing a birth partner, and now everybody is recommending, and the hospital is not requiring. Everyone is recommending rooming in, and nobody is requiring baby to be separated. So that is good news. The question is just whether my husband would be allowed with me if I were to test positive, or if either of us were to have symptoms. So that's why we're trying to stay very safe and very separate from everybody. As of tomorrow, when I go officially on maternity leave, we're going to be pretty much isolating ourselves from our whole family until after the baby is born. Very minimally, my husband might have to go into the office a lot, but we're taking all the precautions we can, only doing grocery pickup once a week, stuff like that. So we're doing everything we possibly can to avoid getting sick, and that fortunately is our privileged position to not have to worry financially about having to like keep working or anything like that. My husband goes on maternity leave, or on paternity leave, as soon as the baby is born, or on my due date, I think, whichever comes first. And I fortunately am able to take disability because California has pretty decent, as far as the US is concerned, pretty decent laws for maternity leave. I mentioned they only want me to go to 41 weeks at the latest. If you have not had a cesarean, they generally will let you go to about 42 before talking about induction. The other thing is that too much Pitocin is not really recommended for VBACs, and so if we got to 41 weeks and there was no sign of labor, I might have to have another C-section, which is the one thing I'd like to avoid. So I'm doing everything I can to try to prepare my body for delivery, for a vaginal spontaneous delivery. So I've been eating dates, which I guess prepare your cervix, I guess. I am planning to do a lot of walking. I've been bouncing around on a yoga ball, and I have plans as of about 38 weeks to start pumping colostrum and saving that in syringes ready for overnight feeds so that I can get a little bit of rest, but also because nipple stimulation helps produce oxytocin, which can induce labor. I've moved from the 15 minutes a day of exercise to the 5 minutes a day regimen, which has been working okay for me. It still seems like a lot, but it's something. And staying active really does help me feel a little bit better. Just generally, things, you know, moving around instead of just sitting at my desk all day does really help me feel better. I'm going to be checking in with you a little bit more as we go into my sort of wishy-washy schedule of maternity leave videos. So look forward to more details about the progression of my pregnancy and symptoms starting from 2 weeks from now. Next week is going to be that video I keep mentioning, it's coming, where I kind of go over everything that my plans are for like content during my maternity leave. So around the time that baby comes, videos might get a little bit less production quality-ish. I mean, I'm out here with like whatever, but anyway, the point is stay tuned, like and subscribe. If you are not into TMI stuff, this is the point where I say goodbye and I'll see you in the next video on Thursday. But now Amy Briggs, who commented on my 6 month bump day video, this bit is for you. I haven't really been hiding anything. I'm pretty open about like bodily functions. I guess I just talked about nipple stimulation before sending people off who were squeamish, so I probably should have put that after the break. But yeah, I heard that some people get like constipation, especially early in pregnancy. It was funny because I went in for my very first appointment. Sorry about the neighbor dogs. I went in for my very first appointment at like 7 weeks, and the doctor was like, you might experience some constipation. And I'm like, yeah, I pooped 3 times today. I don't think that's gonna be my issue. And it hasn't been. I've had the opposite problem a few times. Not like regularly, but not infrequently. And I guess generally that's just how I am, so it's fine. And you know, with it being, I guess, an early symptom sometimes of COVID, it can be a little bit concerning. But generally, that has been more likely. I have an urgency after my morning coffee that to pass my bowels, so that works. Okay, this one time, probably second trimester sometime, I was getting ready for the shower and I was, you know, examining my, because I have been checking to see if colostrum has been coming and stuff. And there was a little white spot just like just under my nipple on one side. And it looked kind of zit-like. And it was weird because like a lot of times there is like a sort of white secretion that comes out of some of the pores around my nipple. And I've been told not to mess with it, but I kind of can't help squeezing at it sometimes. So I thought that's what it was, and I squished it, and it wasn't just a little tiny bit that was like, it like squirted out, and it was weird because I'm not sure if it was actually just a zit that was like, it didn't hurt or anything. I don't know if it was a zit on my nipple or if it was like a clogged milk duct, which doesn't make a lot of sense because the colostrum I have been getting has been clear, and this was white and pretty thick. So, and again, no pain, so that's good. But yeah, I've never gotten a clogged duct in my second trimester before. So that was weird. I don't know what that was, but it hasn't come back. And this is for you because you asked. In my third trimester, my crotch smells different than it does other times of my life. And I'm not a big fan. And I thought that maybe it was just a, you know, pregnancy gives you a heightened sense of smell. I thought I was the only one, because I mostly noticed it when I was wiping or whatever. But I asked my husband, he's like, yeah, no, I've noticed. And so it's, I hope it's only him and me. Nobody else is like noticing that I stink or anything like that. But yeah, some people complain about lochia smelling. I honestly, it was a relief when I had the lochia smell from my first daughter, because I thought that kind of smell almost sweet and like not as bad as the sort of swamp crotch I get in my third trimester. So there you go. I'm glad that you asked. And I hope that you enjoy all of that. So, again, don't forget to subscribe. I will see you guys in the next video on Thursday. That's all about that. I'm blushing. Okay, bye guys.